Welcome back to another Serial Killer Saturday. Today's man of the hour was a requested one, Peter Curtin, also known as the Vampire of Dusseldorf. Curtin was convicted of 9 murders, though he was suspected of committing up to 68. His victims were mainly women and girls. His motivation was sexual sadism, which can be traced back to his childhood. Curtin was the eldest of 13 children. Born in 1883, his childhood was one of unremitting poverty and violence. The Curtin family rented a one-bedroom apartment and lived in fear of Peter's father, a molder by trade, a habitual drunkard. He would return home from the local inn, beat his children. Peter, as the eldest, felt the brunt of the violence, and then rape his wife in front of them. In later years, he also sexually assaulted his daughters. 19th century Germany was no place for a battered wife, and Peter's mother was forced to endure her violent marriage in silence. Subjected to this daily routine of violence, Peter became twisted and formed an unhealthy friendship with a dog catcher who lived in the same building. At the age of 9, Peter pushed a friend off a raft as they played in the River Rhine. When another boy jumped in to try and help the drowning youngster, Peter held him under the water until he suffocated. The death of the two boys was attributed to an accident, and Peter was cleared of any blame. Curtin ran away from home at the age of 16, and shortly afterward, his father was jailed for 3 years after being convicted of incest with Peter's 13-year-old sister. Peter lived by his wits and often stole food and clothing to survive. He would be in and out of jail for the next 24 years and claimed his brutal treatment in the penal system made him hellbent on wreaking revenge on society. A charming, handsome, and when money allowed it, dapper young man. Curtin did not have trouble attracting women, but his violent lust and complete lack of empathy or normal human emotions meant that he was incapable of falling in love. In May of 1913, not long after being released from prison again, he was prowling the streets of Cologne, looking for somewhere to rob. Above an inn, he found a young girl asleep in her bed. When the body of 10-year-old Christine Klein was found the next morning, suspicion fell on her uncle, Otto, who had argued with the girl's father the night before and threatened to do something he would remember all his life. Otto was charged with the murder, but fortunately acquitted by a jury, which decided there was insufficient evidence. The identity of Christine's killer would not become clear for another 18 years. In 1914, with war clouds growing over Europe, Curtin was called up into the Kaiser's army. But military life did not suit the self-centered and ill-disciplined Curtin, and he soon deserted. He was caught and sent to jail, and would remain there throughout the war and its aftermath. Curtin spent much of his time in solitary confinement. He would often deliberately infringe rules so he could be locked up alone, and would spend his time amid violent fantasies. He would imagine attacking people, setting fires, and even sabotaging railways in order to kill as many people as possible. On his release in 1921, he went to stay with his sister in the small town of Altenburg. There he met his future wife, a former prostitute who herself had spent 4 years in jail for shooting a man who had jilted her at the altar. She was eaten up by guilt and spent the rest of her life convinced that she must accept her fate to gain redemption for her sins. Eventually, they wed and lived in Altenburg until 1925. With Curtin gaining employment in a factory as a molder, he also became an active trade unionist. The couple moved to Dusseldorf to find work, and Curtin gradually found his self-control eroding. Between 1925 and 1928, he attacked 4 women in Dusseldorf, strangling them to the point of unconsciousness, often during sex. He also took up arson and would derive sexual satisfaction from imagining that a tramp was burning alive in a barn that he had just torched. Then on the night of February 9, 1929, he waylaid an 8-year-old girl, Rosa Oliger, as she walked down a Dusseldorf street. She was stabbed 3 times and found under a hedge. Curtin, who had tried to set fire to the body with petrol, later recalled having an orgasm at the height of the attack. The murder of Rosa Oliger was only the start of a stream of attacks on women, girls, and occasionally men in and around Dusseldorf. Some, such as Maria Kuhn, survived. She was stabbed 24 times. The reign of terror lasted throughout 1929 and into 1930, and the panic and outrage grew in the Dusseldorf area as each crime was luridly recounted in the German newspapers, with references to monsters and vampires. One of the most horrendous crimes occurred on August 23rd in 1929, as people in town were celebrating an annual affair. Curtin approached 2 foster sisters as they left the fair and asked the older one, Louise Lenzen, 14, to run an errand for him. "Would you be very kind and get some cigarettes for me? I'll look after the little girl," he said. Louise agreed, but as soon as she was out of sight, he strangled 5-year-old Gertrude Hamaker and slit her throat. When Louise returned, she too was dragged off the path, strangled, and almost decapitated with Curtin's pocket knife. The attacks, many of them fatal, continued throughout the summer and autumn of 1929. On November 7th, after killing 5-year-old Gertrude Albermann, Curtin sent a map to local newspapers showing where her body could be found under a pile of builder's debris. She had been strangled and stabbed 35 times. German police had a few clues to go on. Those who had survived the attacks were only able to give a basic description of a tall white man, which could have fitted half the residents of Dusseldorf. Curtin continued his onslaught throughout the winter and spring of 1930, but unfortunately, he did not claim any more lives. Then on May 14th of 1930, an unemployed domestic servant called Maria Budlick arrived in Dusseldorf from Cologne looking for work. The Great Depression had hit Germany particularly hard, and millions were jobless. She met a man who offered to show her the way to a boarding house where she could stay the night. But when he tried to show her a shortcut through the park, she became worried, and, remembering the newspaper stories about the vampire of Dusseldorf, began arguing and making her excuses. Suddenly, a second man intervened on her behalf and rescued her from the first man. Maria told the man she was out of work and had nowhere to go, and he offered to put her up in his apartment. He did not introduce himself, but his name was Peter Curtin. He took her back to his apartment. His wife was away for the night, and he tried to have sex with her, but she demurred, and he agreed to find her somewhere else to stay. They got a tram, and he then led her into the woods. It was there that Curtin grabbed her by the neck and raped her before leading her back to the tram and letting her go free. Asked later why he had not killed her, he said, "I had no intention of killing her, as she offered no resistance. I also did not think that Budlick would be able to find her way back to my apartment." But Maria remembered the street name and Curtin's apartment vividly. Deeply traumatized and ashamed of the stigma of being a rape victim, she did not go to the police, but wrote a letter to a friend telling her of the experience. By chance, the letter was misdirected and was opened by a woman, who immediately took it to the police. Detectives traced Maria Budlick and persuaded her to give a full account of the incident. Eventually, she led officers back to 71 Met Manor Straws and saw Curtin on the stairs. She was too terrified to point him out, even in the presence of so many officers, and by the time she did open her mouth, he had packed a bag and fled. Curtin moved into an apartment nearby and told his wife what had happened with Maria Budlick. He told her he would be sent to jail for many years and she would be without his earnings and would be destitute. Curtin recalled later, "She raved that I should take my life. Then she would do the same, since her future was completely without hope." But he came up with a plan. He confessed to her that he was the vampire of Dusseldorf and said she should take advantage to obtain the large reward being offered for information leading to his capture. She eventually agreed. Curtin had planned to carry out one more spectacular attack before his capture, but his wife went immediately to the police, and when he met her again, as arranged, police armed with revolvers surrounded him. Curtin freely confessed to his crimes, and indeed relished going into great detail and seeing police officers and stenographers wincing and grimacing at his horrors. He had relived his crimes many times over in his mind and had almost photographic memory, so much so that he could recall tiny details of Christine Klein's bedroom from 17 years before. Curtin went on trial in April of 1931, and he initially withdrew his confession and pleaded not guilty. But he later changed his mind under questioning by the examining magistrate, and was eventually convicted of 9 murders and sentenced to death. On the night before his execution, his last meal was Wiener Schnitzel, fried potatoes, and white wine. At 6 a.m. on July 2nd of 1931, despite protests by the German Humanitarian League, he was led to the guillotine and beheaded. The nightmare was over. Shortly before he was executed by guillotine, Peter Curtin, the so-called vampire of Dusseldorf, asked the psychiatrist, "Tell me, after my head has been chopped off, will I still be able to hear, at least for a moment, the sound of my own blood gushing from the stump of my neck?" When the doctor replied that his ears and brain probably would function for several seconds after the blade struck, Curtin replied, "That would be the pleasure to end all pleasures." It seems obvious what drove Peter to become a sadistic rapist and killer. However, why then were not all of his siblings murderers as well? How was it that only his young mind absorbed and morphed into something so dark that he would turn into a monster, and the rest of his siblings simply victims of their upbringing? If you figure it out, let me know. See you next time.